Dear members, the next item in the order prepares a motion on marriage equality. The Business Committee agreed up to 1 hour, 30 minutes for this debate. Proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose a motion, 10 minutes to wind, and all other speakers will have 5 minutes. As a valid petition of concern was presented on Monday, the 28th of April, in relation to the motion, the vote will be in a cross-community basis. And I would ask the clerk to please read the motion.
That the motion relating to marriage equality standing on the order paper be agreed.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mullen Sinn Féin, an Ceart, an Cóan, an Asociálta, Gnéish, agus Cultúrtha. Sinn Féin advocates the right to social, economic, gender, and cultural equality. This encompasses equality for all, irrespective of race, age, marital or family status, sexual orientation, physical or mental capacities, ethnicity, social origin, political or religious affiliations. Creating the conditions for establishing an equal society means recognising the many diverse groups and sections of Irish society that need protection from the state. We must tackle the trend to blame a person or group for their exclusion from society. Irish Republicans are only too aware of what it means to be treated as second-class citizens. Our politics are the result of decades of resistance to marginalisation and discrimination. There were demonstrations held last night in Belfast and Derry, organised by the National Union of Students and the Union of Students of Ireland. I was at the Belfast event. It is fitting that it was held at City Hall, the first council in Ireland to pass a motion in favour of equal marriage, proposed by Sinn Féin councillor Mary Ellen Campbell. I want to pay tribute to the National Union of Students and the Union of Students of Ireland, to Rainbow, to Cara Friend, to Amnesty International, to the Equality and Human Rights Commissions for their very strong stand on this important issue. They all deserve credit because it is a brave thing to do, to stand up for your rights loudly and proudly. What struck me about last night was the number of young people who speak out on this important issue. My Shiv, well done, leading from the front. Those young people come from all communities, from all political and religious beliefs and all affiliations. But what unites them is a strong belief that enough is enough. They instinctively understand the damaging effects the gay bashing has, the inequality and discrimination has on the LGBT community. And attitudes are changing all over Ireland, all over England, all over Scotland, all over Wales, and all over Europe and throughout the world. In some ways, it reminds me of how attitudes changed in a very short period of time around the issue of unplanned pregnancy. Women and girls who became pregnant were expected to hide, give their babies up for adoption, travel abroad, and on many occasions never come back to this country, traumatised and in some cases searching the globe across a lifetime for their children. But a previous generation of women and men, led by feminists, were not willing to allow the criminalisation of women to continue, and the criminalisation of those little babies. It takes courage for our LGBT communities, because in the past, the North was synonymous with the Never, Never, Never Brigade, embodied by the DUP. The DUP were against the decriminalisation of homosexuality. They were against civil partnership. They're now against equal marriage. They're against gay people adopting. They're against people from the gay community donating blood. Against, against, against. What are they for? It takes courage for the lesbian, gay, bisexual and transgendered community, because the fear of rejection by your family is probably the biggest fear of all. It also takes courage because a gay couple know only too well how scary it is in the dark of night that a brick might come in through the window. It takes courage because hate crime is on the rise. And I would urge every single politician in this House to ensure that their words and actions do not fan the flames of hate crime. Do not wring your hands and say you are against violence if your words are the words ringing in the ears of the person throwing the brick in through the window, because you are as guilty as they are. Let's just examine some of the arguments used against marriage equality. Let's just examine them. We shouldn't be wasting public money debating the issue. It's a gimmick. We shouldn't be threatening family values. We shouldn't be redefining marriage. They have civil partnerships. Why do they want marriage? It denies the right to religious belief. Sinn Féin are using it to gain votes. Sinn Féin will lose votes because they're bringing it forward. And then we have the wild nonsense peddled about around incest and polygamy. And I know the person saying it isn't in the House today. I want to take each of these in turn and respond to them. Wasting public money. This debate and the two other debates we had in this Assembly during this term are not a waste of time or money. Equality is a matter of public interest. The mental and physical health issues of the LGBT community, discriminating against a community and constantly bombarding them with negative messages, takes its toll. And despite the strength, the resilience and courage shown by that community, it impacts on them. And that is why there are higher rates of suicide and self-harm. Is anyone telling me suicide and self-harm is not an issue of public interest? The No Men are using the gimmick argument to try and stop the debate. They're not so worried about wasting public money, and their minister, Mr. Poots, has no problem wasting public money. £48,149 to date, appealing against decisions in the High Court readoption and Supreme Court, and £37,112 on the lifetime ban on blood donations, and I expect those costs to rise. Threatening family values. Same arguments were used to justify the laundries, packing the women away to the laundries so family values wouldn't be threatened, and adoption practices in the past. What threatens family values is discrimination against some members and children in families. Threatening the institution of marriage. Where did we hear this before? The apartheid regime, to justify why white and black cannot marry. Enough said. They have civil partnership, now they want more. Yes, the LGBT community are entitled to full equality, and it is the state's duty to legislate for that. It denies the right to religious belief. I will.
The member is seeking equality, marriage equality, for the gay, lesbian and bisexual community. How is she going to achieve marriage equality for bisexuals in Northern Ireland?
Well, what we need is equality for the LGBT communities. In relation to religious belief, Sinn Féin motion specifically includes, and I quote from the motion, supports freedom of religion by allowing religious institutions to define, observe and practice marriage according to their beliefs, granting them the freedom whether or not to conduct same-sex marriages. End of quote. We are not here to legislate according to our consciences. We are here to legislate on the basis of equality. I want to thank the Catholic and Presbyterian churches for sending letters lobbying us to vote against this, as is their right to do. And I would encourage them to engage with us and the LGBT community on this important issue. I am not even going to waste time dealing with the offensive claims made by a member of this House on the media yesterday around polygamy and incest. What I would say is, well and truly fanning the flames. We now have marriage equality in South Africa, in Belgium, in Denmark, in France, in Iceland, in Netherlands, in Norway, Portugal, Spain, Sweden, Argentina, some parts of Mexico and the United States of America, Uruguay, Canada, New Zealand, England and Wales. We will soon have it in the south of Ireland. We will also have it here in the north of Ireland. The best way would be for this House to legislate for it. But failing that, I have no doubt that the LGBT communities will continue to legally challenge discriminatory decisions in local and international courts. And why wouldn't they? Lanner I.
Mr. Storey.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. There are many pressing issues that face Northern Ireland. Those issues impact on all our families and all our communities. And it is yet again unfortunate that those issues are not being addressed in this House today. Rather, that we are returning to an issue which has been rejected. On each previous occasion, this House has rejected same-sex legislation. And I am confident that the outcome of this debate today will be the same. I am sure that it won't stop the parties opposite from subjecting us to further similar motions in the months to come. But the answer will still be the same. Mr. Speaker, marriage has only one definition. It is a lifelong commitment between one man and one woman. That has been the accepted position since the dawn of creation. It is a creation institution. But as the Evangelical Alliance in England has said, marriage is now a fluid, gender-neutral institution defined by consumer demands and political expediency, and it is likely that pressure for further change will follow. The Archbishop of Canterbury stated, "Marriage is abolished, redefined, recreated, being different and unequal for different categories." This is a reminder of the seriousness of the issue that faces us as a society. The traditional value of a family unit is the bedrock of any stable society. It has been undermined in many ways in the last number of years, and I believe that we all reap the consequences in our communities. But the redefinition of marriage would represent a change of monumental significance. It must not happen in Northern Ireland. I know that I speak for a large number of people across the community divide. And often when we come to this House, we are always challenged about being in the sectarian camp. On this issue, members, many Protestant and Roman Catholics, people of other persuasion or of none, want no change to the definition of marriage. Many within the Roman Catholic community feel let down and indeed betrayed by their political representatives. And they are turning to this party as the only major party in this assembly that takes a clear and unambiguous stand on this issue. This is not an issue for trivial dismissals. This is not an issue for political bantering. This is an issue of the utmost seriousness that this House today needs to respect. Sinn Féin are always very keen to portray themselves, as we have heard, as the champions of equality and human rights. But today's motion has nothing to do with equality or human rights. The European Court and other legislators have ruled that same-sex marriage is not a human rights issue. That is a fact. I know it is difficult for some to accept, but that is how it is. During the campaign for civil partnerships, we were told that those partnerships would ensure equal rights in law for same-sex couples and that there would never be any campaign for full marriage. here we are today.
Member give way.
I will give way.
Does the member agree that whenever people talk about the thin edge of the wedge, that this issue is something that does cause real concern? And when we see people who have been tried already in court in England, people who have been sacked from jobs for expressing a viewpoint, it is an issue of major concern and real concern that people will be forced to do things against their will. And no matter what goodwill parties may have, they have no control over how the courts interpret things thereafter. And consequently, this is a freedom of conscience issue.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I concur with the comments of my colleague. And it leads me on to the point and the broader issue that the LGBT agenda is part of a much broader campaign to bring about a social revolution, and pressure for further change will undoubtedly come. This is the beginning of a process that will undoubtedly continue. And if we follow the spurious argument that it's all about equality and human rights and love and so on, then the logical outworking of that can go in many ways. If a man says he loves his sister or his brother or wants to marry them, then surely that is his human right. Or if a group of people of whatever gender decide they love each other and want to get married, then why not? And that's just a few of the possible scenarios. I, in conclusion, Mr. Speaker, will quote what the Apostle Paul said in Ephesians 4 and verse 15, speaking the love and truth, and I want this quote to be placed on record, so that we dispense the issue of homophobic actions. Loveless truth is brutal. Truthless love is hypocrisy. Love in truth is necessary.
Mr. Brad.
Gro míle mai agat cion cóile agus tá áthas orm an seans a bhéagam con lórtseir an rún tábhachtach seo. Mar a dearim is rún tábhachtach atá fi bhráid an tionóil inniu. Mar go mbaineann sé le cearta tábhachtacha do dhaoine. Agus sílim go bhfuil cochramas éirithe in sa rún seo, in sa bhéidis go n-aithníonn sé cearta an locht creidimh agus cearta na ndaoine sin atá i gcéilimh a gceart. So thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, for the opportunity to speak here today. And I thank those who brought this motion forward to the House. I think it's a balanced motion insofar as it seeks to uphold the rights of all concerned. And I'd like to pay tribute to the late P.A. McLaughlin, a member of the SDLP who was a pioneering crusader for LGBT rights here in Northern Ireland. Yes, this is a debate about rights and about equal rights. It's also a debate about freedom, freedom from discrimination, freedom from stigmatisation. It's about legal protections, responsibilities, rights, obligations and benefits afforded by the legal institution of marriage. But, Mr. Speaker, it is also... Yes.
The member has referred to the fact that it's in relation to rights, and would he agree with me it might be worthwhile reflecting on a number of those rights that we're talking about today, and just to highlight one or two of them. The right to time off work to care for a spouse, the right to be considered next of kin for emergency medical decisions, and maybe just one more among a range of others. Unmarried surviving partners do not automatically inherit property should their loved one die without a will. These are the types of rights that we're talking about in this debate. Would the member agree?
Yeah, I thank the member for that intervention, and I do agree, and there are further rights that the member could have mentioned. Yes, it is a debate, as I said, about rights, but it's also a debate about real people. It's about sons, daughters, brothers, sisters, uncles and aunts. It's about people who want to live in a loving, secure, stable and permanent relationship protected by the legal institution of marriage. It's about parents who want to see their children in a loving, secure, stable, permanent relationship protected by the legal institution of marriage, about parents who do not want to see their children marginalised, stigmatised or wondering what the future may hold for them. Their love for each other and their commitment to their relationship should be afforded this very same protections and benefits that the rest of us derive from marriage. In this case, it refers to civil marriage. The LGBT community, as I said before in this House, is not asking for more, as some would suggest. It is simply asking for the same, extending the rights to those who are denied them. That should not be seen as a threat to anyone or to those who already have those rights or to their faith or belief or their right to hold a different view. The motion makes a clear distinction between the civil and religious aspects of the issue. It states that all couples, regardless of gender or sexual orientation, should have the same entitlement to marry. But it also states that religious institutions ought to continue to have the right to define, observe and practice marriage according to their beliefs. And the SDLP would be in favour, strongly in favour, of that right also being enshrined in legislation, so that there is absolutely no doubt about the question. Yes.
Thank the member for giving me, but will he not recognise that in a recent case in relation to the Tony Barlow case, those parents, in terms of the first surrogate parents, said this: I want to go into my church and marry my husband. The only way forward for us now is to make a challenge in the courts against the church. That is where this is going to lead.
If the member had been listening to me, I said that the rights of churches and faith communities should be enshrined in legislation. So there is no desire for any religious denomination or any celebrant to be compelled to perform same-sex marriage ceremonies against their beliefs or their faith. As I said, the SDLP strongly believes that that should be the case, and the motion, I think, indicates that. Those who propose equal marriage in Northern Ireland are also committed to the protection of the rights of religious denominations and celebrants who do not wish to conduct same-sex weddings. The motion recognises that the state does not have any role in dictating to religious groups which ceremonies they can and cannot conduct. Mr Speaker, I support the motion. I realise there is a petition of concern, but I think that eventually this motion will prevail.
Danny Kennedy. Mr Kennedy.
Mr Speaker, can I at the outset indicate that I will be opposing the motion? This is the third debate on this issue in approximately 18 months. It's clear to everyone that the decision of this House will not change. And I believe, I say this to the proposer of the motion and her party, I believe that those who tabled this motion are guilty of engaging in a highly cynical political exercise and perhaps electoral exercise that is no benefit for any section of our community, not least the LGBT community, from which presumably Sinn Féin and others expect support. Mr Speaker, I choose not to speak as a minister, nor indeed on behalf of the Ulster Unionist Party. The House will know that my party believes that issues of this nature are matters of personal conscience. Therefore, although called as an Ulster Unionist, I speak in a personal capacity. And it is a matter of regret, Speaker, that members of all political parties are not allowed the liberty to speak freely to their conscience on this issue. In the previous debate on this matter, I made clear my opposition to any change in the current legislation to allow same-sex marriage. That remains my position. It's a position based on my religious beliefs. It's a position that I believe that is consistent with the teaching of my church, the Presbyterian Church, and indeed the publicly expressed views of other churches, including both the Roman Catholic Church and the Church of Ireland. And finally, it's a position that is fundamentally consistent with the teaching of Holy Scripture.
I would ask the member if he believes in religious freedom, and if so, whilst it's his belief that same-sex couples marrying is outside his religious views, does he agree that religious institutions that wish to have the freedom to bless the either civil partnerships or, should we get it, marriages of same-sex couples should have the religious freedom to do so?
Grateful to the member for his intervention. My position is that the most fundamental position is the teaching of, not of any church, but the teaching of Holy Scripture itself. And it is clear to me that that teaches that there should be no change in the current situation. And I ask the members who support the motion to consider this point, and it is a point that I rehearsed in the previous debate. The law of the land is something that it is necessary for all of us to obey. Indeed, as public representatives, we have an obligation to do so. But I contrast that with obeying the teaching of the church, not a church, the church. And that's an entirely personal and voluntary decision based on individual free will. The historic separation, therefore, of church and state becomes of extreme importance. The church should never be the slave of the state, and consequently the state has no right to dictate the terms of religious marriage to the church. The state has created the mechanisms under which same-sex civil partnerships can be enacted with protections under the law, which in most cases are equivalent to the rights enjoyed by married heterosexual couples. In my view, it is neither sensible nor desirable to allow the state to interfere in the religious institution of marriage simply for political convenience. Redefining marriage would have far-reaching consequences for our entire society. Furthermore, I do not believe that there is widespread public support in Northern Ireland for such a proposal. And, Mr. Speaker, in holding my view, I do not believe that I should be regarded as homophobic. Indeed, any suggestion would offend and abhor me. I do not disparage the LGBT community, many of whom I count as personal friends. Neither is it my role or practice to be judgmental. However, while I remain tolerant of the views and lifestyles of others, the same cannot always be said of all of those who want to promote change of this nature to Christians, whose personal convictions put them at odds on an issue such as same-sex marriage. For the reasons, Mr. Speaker, that I've set out, personal and deeply held convictions that I cannot and I will not set aside, I remain opposed to this proposal.
The order of the Business Committee is arranged to meet immediately after lunchtime suspension today. I propose, therefore, by leave of the Assembly, to suspend the sitting until 2 p.m. And the first item in business when the House returns will be question time. The sitting is by leave suspended.
Order. We will return to the debate on marriage equality, and I call Mr. Chris Little. Mr. Little.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. This will be the second time I've spoken on this issue in the Assembly. I previously voted in favour of an amended motion on the 29th of April 2013, and my contribution will be similar to before. I will speak in support of the motion on behalf of the Alliance Party. It's the vision of the Alliance Party to build a shared society based on religious and civil liberty and equality for all citizens, regardless of age, gender, disability, race, ethnicity or sexual orientation. It's Alliance Party policy to support the extension of civil marriage to same-sex couples and legislative protection for the religious freedom of faith groups and people of faith to define and observe marriage as they determine. I therefore welcome the opportunity to speak on the issue, but I must say that my party and I do believe that respectful and meaningful dialogue are clearly needed if we are going to address the concerns of members of the Assembly and the public in relation to this issue. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I've carefully considered a wide range of sincerely and strongly held views in relation to this issue. There are some people who oppose the proposal, because they believe that equality is afforded to same-sex couples via civil partnerships. Others oppose it because they believe it's against their Christian faith or conscience. Some support it because of their Christian faith or conscience, and some believe that it's the duty of the state to treat all citizens fairly and equally before the law. I believe that the democratic principles of freedom of religion, freedom from religion, and equality before the law for all citizens is the best framework for government by the people, and that they can guide us on this particular issue. As a Christian, I value greatly the freedom of religion that I have in a democracy to live and communicate my faith and my belief that marriage is the voluntary lifelong union of one man and one woman to the exclusion of all others under God. I therefore believe that the religious freedom of people and groups of faith to define and observe their understanding of marriage should be upheld. I also, however, take very seriously my responsibility as a democratically elected representative to uphold not only the principle of freedom of religion, but freedom from religion and equality before the law for all citizens. Mr. Deputy Speaker, it's my assessment that the law on marriage in Northern Ireland, the Marriage NI Order 2003, does distinguish between religious marriage and civil marriage. And this law makes it a legal requirement that civil marriage be conducted with no religious or spiritual basis. The proposal before us is that state-provided civil marriage be extended to same-sex couples with legislative protection for faith groups and people of faith to define and observe marriage as they determine. I therefore find it reasonable that a couple of same-sex orientation, a legal sexual orientation in Northern Ireland, under these principles and these provisions, expects to have access to state-provided civil marriage with legislative protection for faith groups and people of faith to define and observe marriage as they determine. Mr. Deputy Speaker, we've heard quite a few points here today in relation to marriage being undermined, marriage being abolished, thin edges of wedges, and far-reaching consequences. It's my sincere belief that people and groups of faith who have the freedom to define and observe religious marriage as they determine can ensure that aspects of marriage that they hold dear and that they value greatly for themselves and for society can survive and can thrive within this framework. It's for all these reasons, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and in line with the Lads Party policy and our vision for a shared society for everyone in Northern Ireland, that I support the motion. Thank you.
Call Mr. Paul Given.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, the Assembly has voted conclusively on two previous occasions, and I trust it will again today, uphold the institution of marriage as the union between one man and one woman to the exclusion of all others. This definition of marriage has been the foundation of our society, predating governments, but which over time government recognised this union because of its undeniable benefits as opposed to creating the institution. Sinn Féin uses this issue as a weapon to attack those within our society that disagree with their perverse interpretation of equality. A party given its track record as a sister organisation of the Provisional IRA responsible for gross human rights violations is hardly in a position to present itself as a paragon of virtue when it comes to rights. The motion is fundamentally flawed in that it calls for marriage equality to same-sex couples. Marriage being between a man and a woman is not discriminatory. It is the recognition of natural truths that men and women are different and complementary, the biological fact that reproduction depends on a man and a woman. But when it comes to children, those that advance same-sex rights ignore all of the evidence, placing the demands of adults over the needs of children. The motion is also flawed in that if you accept, which I patently do not, marriage should be redefined and extended to same-sex couples on the basis of a loving, committed relationship, then why discriminate against people in multiple relationships? Some in this chamber believe the state should recognise polygamy, but why stop there? Why discriminate against brothers and sisters that have a brotherly and sisterly love towards each other that are in a lifelong, committed relationship? Surely they should have the same legal and financial entitlements if marriage is to be defined as being a loving, committed relationship. This can be the only logical position of those that argue for the redefining of marriage to include homosexuals. Some in the gay rights lobby aggressively attack anybody that takes a contrary opinion and go out of their way to be offended, and yet those that hold to a biblical position or just a logical position, recognising the fundamental physics of procreation and how best to support this reality in the interests of society, are labelled as bigots and homophobic. The Roman Catholic Cardinal Timothy Dolan of New York responded to those that make such accusations when he said, "Unjust discrimination against any person is always wrong, but this law is not unjust discrimination. Rather, it merely affirms and protects the time-tested and unalterable meaning of marriage. The suggestion that this definition amounts to discrimination is grossly false and represents an affront to millions of citizens." Mr. Deputy Speaker, I couldn't agree more. The Human Rights Commission for Northern Ireland has recognised the demand for gay marriage is not a matter of equality. Importantly, the European Court of Human Rights has accepted it is a matter for Member States under Article 9 of the Charter of Fundamental Rights, which states that the right to marry and the right to found a family shall be guaranteed in accordance with the national laws governing the exercise of these rights. I believe in devolution because it allows the people of Northern Ireland to take our own position on all of the issues devolved to us. The issue of marriage is a devolved matter, and within the constitutional arrangements of the United Kingdom, it is for the Northern Ireland Assembly to legislate on this issue, as it was for Westminster in England and Wales, and the Parliament in Holyrood for the people of Scotland. Notably, it was not the courts in any of these jurisdictions within the United Kingdom that changed the law, and it cannot be for the courts in Northern Ireland, to whom some will seek to bypass this democratic institution, to change the law. The courts should not usurp the legitimate role of the Northern Ireland Assembly to take decisions on sensitive social policy that will have far-reaching consequences to the fabric of our society. Increasingly, senior members of civic society have expressed their concerns to me at the commentary on these areas, not just from judicial figures in Northern Ireland, but also from members of the UK Supreme Court. Reassuringly, however, when I met the Vice President of the European Court of Justice recently, we discussed the issue of how European courts give recognition to different laws on social policies within devolved regions of Member States, and he was emphatic in his response that they do. So those that call for the same law within the United Kingdom on this issue are again mistaken, and I trust that not only will politicians and the Northern Ireland Human Rights Commission respect the Assembly's responsibility for this matter, but so too will the courts in Belfast, as any form of judicial activism on this issue would be a gross abuse of that office and a serious and fatal blow to the democratic legitimacy of the Northern Ireland Assembly. I urge the House to reject this motion.
Call Mr. Daffy Mackay, and before doing so, can I encourage members, please, to stay within the remit of the motion that's before the House. Continue.
Graham, I got a last concur. Can I say, first of all, I think a lot of progress has been made on this issue since it first came to the House, and equality, marriage equality will be introduced, and many will look back within this society and other societies in years to come and say, what was all the fuss about? Similarly, in regard to the decriminalisation of homosexuality, which was opposed by the opposite same-sex bench as we have today, also in terms of a number of other issues as well. And people, of course, will have the freedom to disagree with same-sex marriage on their own individual religious views. But as legislators, we have to legislate for everybody. And this legislation that we are proposing will not cover religious groups. It is civil marriage. And the argument today, last kind of clear from the other bench, has been pretty poor. Marriage, they say, is a sanctity. But marriage is what you make of it. Marriage to each and every one of us is something which is absolutely unique. And in terms of marriage as an institution, you know, this argument could be used in terms of adultery or in terms of divorce, but I don't see any legislation coming from those opposed in regard to those particular areas. So this is something that has been rolled out across Europe, it's been rolled out in Britain and rolled out in Ireland, to the south of Ireland very shortly as well. And the north will be left behind and will be an embarrassment because of the DUP and others. And of course, it is no surprise, and the nonsense that we hear from the opposite benches is all, you know, sometimes I think they're obsessed with sex, because that's all they talk about when it comes to the arguments in regard to this particular issue. But I would just like to confirm and ask Conqueror that since this was introduced in England and Wales, there has been no plague of locusts in London. The four horsemen of the apocalypse have not rode into Cardiff. And the sky hasn't fallen in at Liverpool, although that's open to interpretation, perhaps. But all that has happened is that people who love each other have got married. And in England and Wales, that has not in any way lessened anybody else's marriage. In England and Wales, in Scotland and in the South, this will be introduced. And of course, that being the case and the proximity of all those jurisdictions, gay people living here in the North will go and get married anyway. You know, so it's an absolutely... Well, yeah.
The member says that this is all about allowing people who are in love to get married. Can I test just how far he takes that facile argument? If a man says, I'm in love with two women, is he entitled to have polygamous marriage? Does the member's view of equality, a perversion of equality, just as this is a perversion of marriage, does it embrace polygamy? Is he going to say we have to provide for everyone because that's
please.
Their right?
Can I remind members that interventions are supposed to be concise and to the point? Continue.
Well, if the member wants to get married to two women, that's his business. It's nothing to do with this particular argument. It's a heterosexual argument and not a homosexual argument. Okay. Well, the member, as we all know, opposed the decriminalisation of homosexuality. And actually, well, you might not want to have members to be reminded of this, but when it was discussed in 1982, he wanted the British government at that time to derogate from the relevant article in the European Convention on Human Rights. So that is what his agenda is. It isn't anything about polygamy. It has nothing to do with it.
Member will be seated. I have the floor at the moment. Can I remind members that Mr. McKay has the floor? And can I encourage other members, please, to remain quiet and listen to what's been said? Continue.
Under civil law, can heterosexual people marry two wives?
Well, under law at the moment, members of the public have married more than once. There are members in this House who have married more than one woman and more than one man, I am sure. So it is a total separate argument to what we are debating here today. Because at the end of the day, there's a very serious aspect to this in terms of how people from the homosexual, people from the LGBT community are treated within the community, treated within Ireland and further afield. And homophobia is what is fuelling much of this debate here today in terms of the political representation, unfortunately. And what this is about treating gay people lesser than everyone else. And I would like to say, that gay men and women are deserving of the same rights as I have and the same rights that you have. And two people that love each other, having their love recognised through marriage, is no threat to anybody. So I would urge the House today, at Askana Collier, to do the right thing, to think about the consequences of this in terms of prejudice, in terms of bullying, and in terms of suicide, because that is a big issue within the LGBT community. So do the right thing and vote in favour of this motion.
Call Lord Morrow.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Marriage is the voluntary union for life of one man and one woman, to the exclusion of all others. It has been the bedrock of society for generations and has enabled communities to prosper. The Sinn Féin motion before the Assembly today is headed marriage equality, but in fact it is not about equality at all. It is about redefining marriage. It is about removing the traditional and the biblical definition of marriage and replacing it with a new definition. It is about redefining marriage and thereby bringing in a societal change in the understanding of what marriage is. This would be a radical definition of society's most fundamental institution and a radical demonstration of the institution of marriage. The terms husband and wife and indeed father and mother would become meaningless. Of course, some advocates of so-called same-sex marriage argue that this would not interfere in any way with the rights of those who hold to a traditional understanding of marriage, but that is simply not true. Marriage would be redefined for everyone, and our historic understanding of marriage as the union of one man and one woman would be replaced by a new paradigm for marriage as the union of two people regardless of gender. This is about imposing a new genderless definition and a new genderless version of marriage on the whole of society. Thereby, this new redefined version of marriage as a genderless institution would be the only legalised definition of marriage in Northern Ireland. This new definition of marriage would become the norm and would be taught in our schools as being the norm, even to young children, thereby interfering with the rights of parents to pass on their own values to their children. The true nature of marriage cannot be changed by parliaments or assemblies, but rewriting the definition of marriage would lead to confusion about marriage and would erode and downgrade the status of marriage in society. Advocates of this same-sex marriage say that there can be a distinction between civil marriage and religious marriage, and that they want to redefine civil marriage with leaving religious marriage alone. That is impossible. There can be only one definition of marriage in society. Whether the wedding be in the form of a civil ceremony or a religious ceremony, the outcome is the same, and that is the joining together of a man and a woman in marriage. The ceremonies may be different, and the settings may be different, but the institution is the same. Redefining marriage as a genderless institution would mean merging two things which are radically dissimilar under the single word marriage. A same-sex relationship and a traditional marriage would both be recognised by the state as being the same thing and would be promoted by the state as being the same thing. This legal redefinition would abolish the traditional definition of marriage. I am pro-marriage and pro-family, and I believe that we would be going down a very wrong road today if we were to redefine such a fundamental institution. I implore the House today to reject the motion before it. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
I call Ms. Bronwyn McGaffin.
Sinn Féin is a party that is committed to the equality agenda, and we believe that all citizens, regardless of race, religion or sexuality, should be treated as equals in the eyes of the law. Human rights should be enjoyed by everyone without discrimination. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights makes reference to the fact that everyone is entitled to all the rights and freedoms set forth in this declaration without distinction of any kind, such as race, colour, sex, language, religion, political or other opinion, national or social origin, property, birth or other status. In addition to this, the Declaration states that everyone is entitled to equal rights as to marriage, during marriage and at its dissolution. While Article 18 states that everyone has the right to freedom of thought, conscience and religion, I think it is important to make it clear that this right also extends to religious groups and organisations who have the right to freedom of religion. Overall, the Universal Declaration makes it clear that no matter who we are, what we look like or where we come from, we are entitled to equality and human rights. I recognise and respect that there are deeply held religious, cultural and personal views, but we must respect and appreciate the views of each individual with regard to this very important issue. As a party, Sinn Féin advocates the right to social, economic, gender and cultural equality. The rights of the LGBT community and human rights are not separate, they are one and the same. You cannot support equality and be a racist, and you cannot support equality and perpetuate sexual discrimination, and you cannot support equality and be homophobic. All MLAs represent every section of our community, including our LGBT members, and this motion is about ensuring marriage equality for everyone, regardless of their sexual orientation. There is a growing number of states which allow same-sex marriages, along with France and the UK. Other countries, including Spain, Canada, the Netherlands, Argentina, have extended marriage rights, as well as 9 US states. And the yes?
The member for giving way. And she mentioned some of the states that have changed their laws to allow for same-sex marriages, as Katrina Rann also did. Can she confirm that none of those states have went on to legalise polygamy, and equally in none of those states have they challenged the church's right to define marriage how they see fit?
Yeah, I think you're right on that one, and that's really stating the obvious, I think, here today in the House. But thank you for that intervention. No, I don't think there's any point. I really don't think there's any point. The Constitutional Convention in Dublin voted in favour of extending marriage rights to same-sex couples. 79% of members voted to recommend that the Constitution be amended to allow for same-sex marriage, and the Convention's recommendations will hopefully be viewed by the Government quite soon. Every citizen should enjoy the same rights and entitlements under state law, and that includes those in relation to marriage. What churches do is a matter for churches, but the state needs to treat everyone with equality. And it is important to note that this motion supports religious institutions to define, observe and practice marriage according to their beliefs. All family forms should be given equal respect and value in the law. The traditional family form based on marriage should not be given higher status in law or practice than any other family form. Law and social policy should recognise the diversity of family life in Ireland. All families, including unmarried families, have the same rights to respect, care, support, protection and recognition. The Equality Act regulations and sex discrimination regulations states that it is unlawful for service providers to discriminate against a person because of his or her sexual orientation and the provision of services and public functions. Surveys have showed that negative perceptions about lesbian, gay and bisexual people were getting progressively worse here in the north of Ireland, and a report on mental health has showed that a quarter of young gay or bisexual male in the north of Ireland have attempted suicide. There is no doubt that the lesbian, gay and bisexual people are valued within our society and seen as participating members of society. There remains prejudice and barriers to accessing equality of opportunities. For Man and Man, Dwayne Vance, who is here in the public gallery, in an article in last week's Impartial Reporter, and who comes from a unionist point of view, would prefer equal marriage to be brought through Stormont rather than through the Supreme Court in London. And finally, this Assembly today, by supporting the motion, can give a strong message that prejudice, discrimination and intolerance must be rejected. Gura miogat.
Call Mr Colm Eastwood.
Thank you very much, Mr Deputy Speaker, and can I thank the proposers of this motion for bringing it forward. I think it's important, albeit it seems somewhat pointlessly because there's a petition of concern down. It's important still that this Assembly debates this motion, that this Assembly recognises that we have a lot of people in our community who would love to see this motion passing today. In fact, recent polls would say a majority of people. And what all those figures show is that it's an increasing number of people year on year who support this policy. And I think that's the thing that's been lost in all of this. People's society's opinions around these issues have changed. They've changed because of their own experiences. They've changed because of their families' experiences, and they've changed because of their community's experiences. And I think, Mr Deputy Speaker, they have changed for the better. I was very proud, as when I was Mayor of the City of Derry, to lead, along with other public representatives, lead the first Foyle Pride March in our city. And you wouldn't believe the number of people who were out in our community supporting that festival. That's happened right across the north. It's happened right across this country. And I think that's a very positive step. It shows that this community is moving forward and is prepared to view members of the LGBT community as part, a full and equal part of our society. I do understand that people have a difficulty with this. I understand that people have a deeply held religious view in this, and I have no difficulty with that. That's what democracy is about. That's what a modern democracy is supposed to be able to accommodate. But what's important, if I can respect that point of view, people need to respect the fact that many people in our society from the LGBT community feel left out, feel left behind, feel as if this Assembly has a lot of work to do to make them feel as full members and full citizens of this country, and I think that's a lesson that we all need to learn. Lots of figures have been said today about the number of young people who struggle with depression and difficulties around coming to terms with a lot of these issues. This Assembly has a duty of care to them. And we have a duty of care, I believe, to say that this is not about diminishing marriage. This is about strengthening it. This is about ensuring that more people can have access to this great institution. You know, I'm not somebody who's against marriage. I actually get married in December, whether that was a good idea or not. But I believe very strongly, hopefully she's not watching. I believe very strongly in the institution of marriage. I believe that two people, don't all get upset now, two people who love each other and are prepared to commit to each other in that loving relationship should be afforded that recognition by the state. Oh, well, yeah.
I thank the member for giving way. And he mentions the importance of marriage, and numbers of people getting married has actually been going down. Does he not agree that people who are actually willing to campaign for the right to marry show such a great commitment to that institution?
Member is an extra minute.
Thank you, and I thank the member for his intervention, and he makes a very good point. We're all saying here that we believe very strongly in the institution of marriage, and it is an institution that isn't people aren't exactly queuing up around the block to get involved in or to stay committed to. These are people who want to be married, who want to do all. Well, surely, go ahead.
May I just to the member that in the last, since 2005, 66,529 marriages have occurred in Northern Ireland and only 727 civil partnerships. So it looks like traditional marriage is pretty popular in Northern Ireland.
Well, that's good to hear. Unfortunately, a lot of people don't have the option to get married, and that's what this is about today. And I would hope that the member opposite would join with us and get rid of your petition of concern and join with us and recognise that there's many unionist people out there who'd love to be married as well. This is not a nationalist unionist issue. Unfortunately, it's being portrayed as this. Marriage has been an institution that has evolved over time. 150 years ago, Catholics and Protestants in Ireland couldn't be married. Couldn't be married at all. Now they can. Marriage used to be a property transaction rather than an institution where two people loved each other and wanted to commit to each other. It used to be the case, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that if a man was accused of rape, that would be all right if the victim was his wife. That's how far we've come in society. Adultery used to be a criminal offence. Divorce in Ireland wasn't legal. You know, it was only in 1981, because of the Dudgeon case, that homosexuality was actually decriminalised. So I'm not despairing here, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I'm very, very confident that in time, whether it's in this House or whether it's in a court of law somewhere, that this part of either Britain or Ireland, however you want to describe it, will catch up with the rest of these islands, and will catch up with the rest of the way the Western world is going. And I am very confident that those people out there who we have turned our back on, Mr. Deputy Speaker, who we haven't shown that they're proper and true and equal members of our society, will finally one day be entitled to access that great institution that is marriage. Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
Call Mr. Michael Copeland.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And I rise not wishing to tread on the faith sensibilities of anyone, but to simply speak for myself, from my own personal experiences, on behalf of people that I have known through constituency work in my office. As is patently obvious, I'm neither a lawyer nor a theologian. I'm just over 60 years of age, closer in many ways to the last chapter than the first in my own journey. And the world has changed immeasurably in the 60 years that I've been in it. Things that were beyond comprehension 10, 20, 30, 40 years ago are now viewed differently. And in my constituency work and within my own family, I have seen the disastrous implications that flow from the prejudice that is felt by those who know themselves to be different by reasons of gender, where their feelings and affections are viewed by society as being in some way corrupt, in some way incapable of being spoken about in polite society. I have had young people in my office driven almost to the point of suicide. A young woman born within the shadow of this building, confined to her room for a period of about 6 months, and continual attempts made to exorcise, if whatever that means, this demon that was allegedly possessing her. Marriage has been held up as an institution. I know. I've been married for 32 years, I think. I did some research, incidentally, just to introduce a degree of laxity prior to the last vote, and I met a guy on the Newton Arms Road outside a public house who had obviously had several beers, and I asked him his opinion as to what I should do in this vote on equal marriage. And his gruff Belfast reply was, "Is that the gay thing?" I said, "Yes." He says, "What did I tell you, Michael? I've been married to a woman for 30 years and I wouldn't recommend it to anyone. If gay people want to get married and be as miserable as me, it's up to them." And there is a truth that runs through that, that says, live and let live. The institution of marriage is a legal position. And it has changed throughout the years. I was going to say as recently as 1782, but the actual date is 1782. Presbyterian weddings were adjudicated unlawful. Presbyterian form of worship was adjudicated unlawful to such a degree that up to thousands of people had to row from Donaghadee to Scotland every time to be afforded freedom of worship according to their choice. The children of those marriages were considered illegitimate, and the marriages themselves null and void unless they were re-performed in a Church of Ireland parish and a stipend paid to the minister. That changed. I do not know the moral rights and wrongs of this, but I know that the words that we use in this chamber will echo, and they will echo reinforcing prejudice, not reinforcing prejudice. But we must bear in mind that the ultimate judgment, to me, on issues of morality are with a much higher authority than that exercised within this House. And I personally do not consider myself a worthy person to sit in judgment, moral or otherwise, of the emotions of other human beings.
Call Mr. Basil McRae.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I must say I'm surprised by the argument made from the benches opposite with going with the title of unionists. When the England and Wales, when Scotland, when the rest of the United Kingdom thinks that it's a good idea, and in fact the Prime Minister said it sends out a powerful message to the rest of the world, I'm surprised that they distance themselves from it. I'm also conscious that the message that we send out from this chamber is also a powerful message. I am disappointed that people have felt yet again the need to have a petition of concern, because that means that no matter what vote we have, nothing will happen. So we get into a situation about why are we having this debate. Earlier speakers have talked about homophobia, about the bullying that comes from it, about the suicides, about the victimisation, and I do think that people on other benches that profess not to worry about homophobic activity or about gay activity are actually not telling us the real truth. There is actually a reaction against that, and you can dress it up any way you like about saying, "Oh no, I don't want to do that," but you know, whatever. That's not the truth. Some people in this chamber have spoken, I think it was Mr. Kennedy, saying that he had a deep personal conviction. I have to say to you, I think it is really, really wrong that we allow personal morals to influence what should be a legislative assembly. I do not think that this should be a free vote. I think this should be a proper whip vote. Because this... I'm sorry, I won't take it. I've got not enough time. So there is an issue here about people recognising that there is a debate that has to be had. And I have to say to you, at some stage, we will need to confront this properly. Members here present might consider bringing forward a private members' bill where we can actually deal with the issues. Now, of course, I understand that members opposite will oppose it. At least in that particular position, I know that that is their standing. And I can also admit that there is deep disquiet within our society from certain quarters that must be respected. I will tell you that one of the things that attracted me about this motion is that it actually said there would be no imposition on churches or people of faith to do things that are not in their philosophy. That is the standard that we have to prevail. And I did hear people talk about the Catholic bishops or the archbishops talking. There is a prohibition, as I understand it, from the Roman Catholic Church about divorce. Yet I don't see any legal challenge coming forward and saying, let me force my second marriage to go through in your church. These things are scurrilous. They do not happen. They are red herrings. Now, there's an issue that was brought up, perhaps, and I've been waiting for Mr. Alistair to maybe interject on the issue of polygamy, which was a great challenge that he put out there. You see, the real issue here is I would have three tests about any legislation. Any legislation. First, does the activity that you're talking about do any harm? Whatever that activity it is, does it do any harm? Secondly, would legislation be effective? Would it be effective? Would it actually make things better or worse, whatever you're trying to do? And finally, does it affect a lot of people? Now, I can tell you, I would be against polygamy because the evidence is that they are not real wives, that you're getting into servitude or you're getting into all of these issues. This was the Supreme Court.
The member says that he would be against polygamy, and one of the tests would be whether or not it causes any harm. Isn't that a moral judgment? And if he's entitled to make a moral judgment as the touchstone as to whether or not you legislate on something, why are the rest of us not entitled to make a moral judgment on whether you legislate for same-sex marriage? He can't have it both ways. If a moral judgment is apt for him, it's apt for everyone else.
The one thing I'll say about Mr. Alistair, when I give him the courtesy of coming to take an intervention, he should be a little bit more succinct in his argument. So the issue is this. The issue is this. I am not giving him the moral right to decide any of these things. I am saying that this is a legislative body that has to legislate for everybody. We are not attacking the institution of marriage. It is an honourable institution, but there are many people in our society that live different lifestyles, different issues, and that's what we have to try and legislate for. And I do remember a great campaign that started something like Save Ulster from Sodomy. Well, look where that got us. So what will happen in the future is that our society is moving forward. It is a wonderful, diverse society made up of lots and lots of different individuals, and our job is to try and find a way to make sure that all people can live together on this. I'm sorry I don't have time, Mr. Kennedy. So our job is to do that. So let me put out a challenge to the xenophobes and the homophobes and those people that think that bullying is okay. Let me say to you, this is not the right way to go forward. Let's have a proper debate. Let's not put out petitions of concern, and let's not have a debate that is constrained to 1.5 hours. Why can't we have the proper discussions backwards and forwards? I would like to engage Mr. Kennedy, and I do apologise for not being able to take him in, but I am short of time to go and do this. So let me say this. This is a signal opportunity for all of the parties in this House to say what they want to do. And I have to say to those parties that is spouse equality, that I do think that all of their members should be voting for their party policy along with NI21.
Yes, a point of order.
Language around xenophobia, homophobia used in the context of those that signed a petition of concern is appropriate language to be used within this Assembly chamber on a very sensitive and emotive issue.
I'm sure the member would agree with me that moderate language at all times is very appropriate. Indeed, there are times that no language is appropriate and there was too much shouting across the chamber. I hope the minister will have greater courtesy than some members had, and I call him now to respond.
In relation to the previous person who raised the point of order, is the member going to refer to the Speaker to look at the language that was used by the previous Speaker when he was making his contribution or not?
I would certainly give it careful consideration, but again I would repeat what I said. Members should choose their language wisely when they're engaging in a debate.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, a motion on same-sex marriage was debated by this Assembly on the 29th of April of 2013. On that occasion, I spoke on behalf of my party to oppose the motion. As I said at that time, the The opposition was not grounded on opposition to what a person is or how a person chooses to live his or her life, but rather on support for the traditional, long-standing, centuries-old definition of marriage. I have listened with great care and interest to the points which members have made during the course of this further debate today. However, my support for the traditional approach to marriage has not waned, and I cannot therefore support the motion. And I will not, as the motion asks me to, be bringing legislation to this House to legalise same-sex marriage in Northern Ireland. The motion suggests that, quote, other jurisdictions on these islands have moved forward with equal marriage rights for same-sex couples. I'm assuming that this is a reference to the British Isles, which includes Great Britain, Northern Ireland, the Republic of Ireland and our offshore islands. Well, Mr. Speaker, the jury is still out in the Republic of Ireland, and I suspect that there are quite a few in that jurisdiction who would be quite happy to align themselves with the position which this Assembly has adopted on previous occasions. Likewise, the Isle of Man has not introduced same-sex marriage. Legal developments in other jurisdictions may be of interest, but they are not determinative of the law in this jurisdiction, and it is wrong to suggest that they should be. Differing laws in different jurisdictions is the very essence of devolution. It is for this Assembly and this Assembly alone, not any other Parliament or Assembly in these islands, and certainly not for any judge in a court, to determine the law of Northern Ireland. When we do decide what the law of this land ought to be, we should do so by reference to principled and informed debate rather than by automatic adoption. Nor too, Mr. Speaker, should we make up our minds on the basis of who shouts the loudest, although I have to say that this is not an issue that especially exercises my constituents, who seem much more interested in jobs, the economy and the health service. Nor should we decide simply because they argue on the grounds of discrimination without testing whether or not an issue of inequality actually exists. This latest motion seeks to emphasise the concept of equality and implies that same-sex couples do not receive equal benefits. When the issue of same-sex marriage was first debated by this Assembly, my colleague Michelle McElveen said that it was time to tear down the smokescreen that this was about discrimination. It is regrettable that that smokescreen is still being maintained by some within this Assembly. People in Northern Ireland have an equal opportunity to enter into a committed relationship with all the benefits that that entails. Opposite-sex couples can do so through marriage. Same-sex couples can do so through civil partnerships. It has been acknowledged, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that a same-sex marriage in England and Wales confers the same benefits as a same-sex civil partnership. Equality, per se, is not, therefore, the issue. Article 16 of the United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights, as upheld by the UN Human Rights Committee, defends the traditional view of marriage. In European law, Article 12 of the European Convention on Human Rights also upholds that definition, and the European Court of Human Rights has deemed the definition of marriage not a matter of equality, but for individual state law. The Northern Ireland Human Rights Commission has highlighted the international treaties that protect the right to marry, but it has conceded that, quote, the restriction of marriage to opposite-sex couples does not violate the international standards, and this is clear from both the international treaties and the jurisprudence of the European Court of Human Rights and the United Nations Human Rights Committee. It is clear, therefore, Mr. Deputy Speaker, then, that the United Nations, Europe and our own Human Rights Commission all agree that this is not an issue of equality. The key questions which we should be asking ourselves are, is the balance of our current law right, and has the range of interests which fail to be accommodated been afforded equal respect? In my view, the answer to both of these questions is an unequivocal yes. Our law already affords same-sex couples legal recognition of their relationship, and at the same time, it respects freedom of thought, conscience and religion. Supporters of same-sex marriage are quick to point to the so-called protections which have been built into the various pieces of legislation in Great Britain. However, leading lawyers have queried how effective those protections will actually be. Moreover, the protections are largely designed to protect the clergy and prevent any claim that a member of the clergy is obliged to conduct a same-sex marriage. They do not protect the religious beliefs of others, such as teachers or registrars, and it is entirely possible that faith organisations in Great Britain will be precluded from accessing public funding services or public buildings because they object to same-sex marriage. I, for one, would not want to see that happening here. Furthermore, Mr Deputy Speaker, I am in no doubt that the same individuals who offer up tokenistic protection for churches today would, if the same-sex marriage were legal in Northern Ireland, be the first to jump on a future bandwagon whenever the inevitable lobby for churches to be required to permit same-sex marriages on their property begins. There will always be those, Mr Deputy Speaker, who call for more and who want their own personal interests to be prioritised above all else. However, I have to place those calls alongside the many other calls for legal reform and must ultimately decide the priority actions. I have done so and I have determined that there are other and more important issues which need to be addressed, issues which are of concern to people across Northern Ireland rather than of concern to one small but very vocal lobbying group. The current law on civil partnership is in place and is operating effectively. I see no need to revisit it at all. In adopting that position, I am neither demeaning nor discriminating against people. Rather, I am ensuring that there are appropriate protections for all and that the current balance of the law is maintained. Mr Deputy Speaker, I want to make it clear that whilst there is obvious disagreement in this House on this issue, that should be no excuse for us to be intemperate. Just as no one has the right to abuse anyone physically, mentally or verbally because of their sexuality, so too it is unacceptable to belittle or besmirch someone simply because they possess a different view from you. It isn't appropriate to brand those who oppose same-sex marriage as bigoted or backward. Good people, Mr Deputy Speaker, people of the Protestant faith, people of the Catholic faith and people of no faith at all oppose same-sex marriage and they shouldn't be lambasted because they do so. For speaking today and saying what I have, I will no doubt be damned by some as a bigot and as intolerant. Nothing could be further from the truth. I don't expect some who support same-sex marriage to accept that because of the personal stance that I have taken on this matter, but it is the truth nonetheless. All I seek to do today is to state my view, a view that I believe is the mainstream view in Northern Ireland. We all need to be careful with our language, be considerate in our choice of words, and treat each other with respect and accept that there are differences. As I have said in this House before, I was always taught that tolerance was when you disagreed with somebody, but you respected their right to have a different position to you. Today, unfortunately, it would seem that for some, when you fail to fall in line with their thinking, you are the intolerant one. Mr Deputy Speaker, I want to place on record my admiration for members of this Assembly who will today display great courage in the face of personal pressure that they have been placed under, both from inside and outside of their parties. Their resolve, Mr Deputy Speaker, stands in stark contrast to others who defy the teachings of the Church that they have been senior members of for years, or others who aren't brave enough to vote the way they really want to and are oddly absent today. Some members, Mr Deputy Speaker, can choose to ignore the deeply held views of the majority of people in Northern Ireland if they wish. I will not. Mr Deputy Speaker, I oppose this motion.
Call Ms Megan Fearon to conclude.
First of all, I just want to start by welcoming the debate today and thanking and acknowledging everyone for participating in what was, for the most part, fairly tempered. And it's actually an honour for me to be able to speak in favour of extending the right of civil marriage to those who are LGBT. Today we have the DUP saying that this isn't an equality issue. And I get that the notion of equality might actually go over your heads, because I think we have over 20 unionist men in the chamber today discussing an equality issue. It's absolute nonsense to say that this isn't an equality issue. Equality is an all or nothing concept. You can't be a little bit equal to someone else. That is just simply not how it works. So civil partnerships are not enough. Equality is not a concept that we should be striving for either. It's an absolute necessity. And of course, in the overall fight for LGBT equality, I think we should recognise that the issue of marriage is just one of the many battles that need to be fought. In the past few months alone, we've seen the disgraceful squandering of public money in the pursuit of a personal agenda against unmarried and same-sex couples by our very own Minister for Health, who ironically is actually trying to limit how many people can perform the simple life-saving act of giving blood. It's nothing short of shameful that people face discrimination every single day of their lives because of nothing more than their sexual orientation. And Katrina Rand referred to earlier about how the fact that hate crime is on the rise, and we should actually absolutely condemn that, and we shouldn't say anything that I think Michael Copeland referred to earlier, that our voices are going to echo from this chamber, and so we shouldn't perpetuate negative views. Thankfully, the Minister's appeals in relation to family and adoption rights were actually rejected. And the old narrative that a child needs a man and a woman to be raised properly is totally incorrect. I think Paul Given referred to it earlier. It's totally incorrect. All a child needs in reality is a loving home and environment to grow up in. And I think that it's actually insulting to single-parent families everywhere to say that someone needs that a child needs a mother and a father to have some sort of wholesome upbringing. And I understand that some people choose to hold very sincere religious beliefs and that they're really important to a lot of people, but they shouldn't be foisted on others, and this absolutely should not impact on the law that affects everyone. I think it's important to note that there are lingering unaddressed inequalities facing those who have undergone gender reassignment. Someone who is married must have a divorce to undergo gender reassignment or have their civil partnership dissolved before they can have a gender reassignment certificate. And I think it's an important point to note, because all too often in these debates on LGBT issues, the transgender community are forgotten. Mervyn's story spoke earlier about his fear of a social revolution and the LGBT agenda, as he put it. I think, you know, maybe you just need to wake up a bit, because there's no revolution. That's just the way the world actually is. And gay people are not looking for any more or any different rights than straight people already have. They just want equality under the law. And for the record, just in case anyone's in any doubt, this is absolutely nothing to do with polygamy. You can't marry more than one person under civil law at present. It's a completely spurious argument.
Order, please. I direct my attention to one particular member who has frequently shouted across the chamber, and I would ask that member not to do it again. Continue.
Name him.
For me, the single most important part of the debate today is the message that we're going to be sending out to young people, particularly young LGBT people who are currently struggling. I mean, the reality is there are people out there who literally would rather not live than be openly who they are because of the intimidation or the discrimination that they would face. And that's just unacceptable. Because they don't conform to the notion of heteronormativity, or they don't stick to distinct gender roles. And to those today who chose to talk about their own particular outdated views, and I'm using moderate language so I don't upset anyone, I wonder if you'd be able to repeat what you've said to the faces of a family who've lost a loved one to suicide because they were gay. It's one thing to go in and do it to a hall full of school children, but the reality is that we're dealing here is real people, real personal struggles and real relationships. And to that end, I wanted to use this opportunity to give as many people as possible a voice inside this chamber. Yesterday, I started a hashtag on Twitter in order to facilitate this. So instead of going over what has been said in here, I want to air some of what's being said out there. So I'm just going to go over some of the tweets that I was sent. And it was all about how I want marriage equality because Leona, because every single person is equal and should not be treated differently because of who they love. Holly Morrison, because I don't think we should have to vote in the first place. Everyone should be able to get married and be happy. Dara Hughes, because civil partnerships are not the same as marriage. LGBT groups deserve equality. Catherine Seeley, question, did we vote on your marriage? Sinead Henry, because the church did not invent marriage, so why should it define who is fit for it? Ellen, because it's 2014, we're still fighting for LGBT rights. It's time we realise that gender and sexuality are social constructs. Dwayne Vance, because I want to be given the right to marry and consecrate my relationship with my soulmate as straight couples do. Lauren, because people don't choose who they love, but we should choose to respect that. Civil partnerships are not enough. Maeve Burns, because love is love. Religion should have no place in politics. Dara Toner, because I should have the same rights and access to marriage and not be treated as a lesser person than a heterosexual. Andrea Nash, because it's the right thing to do. It's a disgrace in 2014 that discrimination against the LGBT community is still rife. Abigail Foran, because denying marriage to two individuals who love each other is to deny them a fundamental freedom. Mary Ellen Campbell, because everyone should be equal under the law and quite simply, it's the right thing to do. Barra O'Murray, because I believe that no one can quantify or judge true love. Louise Riley, because we don't want gay rights, we just want equality, the same laws and the same rights for all. Jess McGowan, because my partner and I will take our life and our business further afield, driving us away, and who else? Aidan Hamill, because it's not a religious issue, it's an equality issue. No one should be denied this basic civil right. Niamh Gallagher, because it's progress and we as a society need to always strive to be better. How can anyone be against love? Willie Quinn, because equality can't be handpicked, the same way rights shouldn't be. Let people who love together be together. Johnny McGibbon, because there's no almost equal, there's equality or no equality. Indeed, I believe that the battle for LGBT rights is the equivalent of the civil rights movement of my generation, and indeed there is a global momentum building towards LGBT equality, and even Stephen Fry was talking about this debate on social media. It's time that this Assembly got its act together, caught up and made its way into the 21st century, and that doesn't just mean endorsing motions or saying that you support something. We can't stop until we've achieved full legislative equality, extending the same rights, privileges and protections to all. The words diversity and inclusivity should be our cornerstone as we work to build a truly shared future for everyone. I want to encourage everyone today to do the right thing and support this motion. And despite the abuse or use of the petition of concern, we can at least have a moral victory if people choose to vote for the motion and not abstain. Thank you.
Order. I would like to remind members that the vote on the motion will be on a cross-community basis. The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Order, please. Members will resume their seats. The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Do we have tellers? Order, please. Members will resume their seats. Tellers for the ayes are Megan Fearn and Katrina Ruan. Tellers for the noes are Adrian McQuillan and George Robison. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors. Order. Members will resume their seats. That means sit down. Clerk, read the result.
94 members voted, of which 43 voted aye, 45.7%. 34 nationalists voted, of which 34 voted aye, 100%. 53 unionists voted, of which 4 voted aye, 7.5%. 7 others voted, of which 5 voted aye, 71.4%. The motion falls.
The motion falls. Unfasten the doors. The Assembly will take its ease for a few moments.